what is the NP problem? There I must focus. This is P is polynomial because when is at the base, number of elements n, n square, n cube, n to the power 4, even n to the power 100 is a smaller problem. What is NP problem? NP problem is not the hardest of the problem. Hardest of the problem is the Turing-Hartree problem. There is no algorithm. What is the difference between NP hard and NP? NP means it is not polynomial. No, that is not the thing. It is that a non-deterministic Turing machine can solve it in a polynomial time. And what is NP complete? This NP complete is very interesting problem. The all NP around 3000 or more NP complete problem it has been found. And the most basic NP complete problem is 3-SAT problem. 3-SAT problem means it is a basically clauses. It is a AND clauses of three variables, and the variables are connected by OR clauses, and like X1 or X2 or X3 bar, like this, like three kinds of variables, and you these clauses, this call have to be ANDed, and 3-SAT variables, it has been proven in 1971 that it is a NP complete problem, because if the solution is hard, but if you get solution, if you just check it, it will take only polynomial time. So what is the advantage of NP complete problem? First of all, it has been proven that it cannot be solved by a P problem, okay, but it is done. Nobody has said that it can't be done. It can be done. So if it is can be solved by a P polynomial algorithm, then all the 3000 problems can be completed by a polynomial problem, and but the checking is very easy. But here if you see a Rubik cube, say this is looks difficult, but it is a polynomial problem. But whenever if you find a chess, like chess, this is not an NP complete problem. This is an exponential problem. Exponential problem means even if you give a solution, it cannot be quickly checked. So these are the different types of algorithmic complexity you should know. Why you are learning? Because whenever you go for context-free grammar, then context-free grammar, your complexity comes, if a number of terminals comes to n, the complexity on cube. But by deterministic context-free grammar, by no ambiguity, we can solve it by LR1 parsing. You know that is LR1 parsing. Most of the deterministic context-free grammar, which is useful for our programming, because 99% of programming frameworks by deterministic context-free grammar, and definitely no ambiguity is there, because all ambiguous grammar it generally can be found in the non-deterministic context-free grammar. But you have to find efficient grammar out of it so that it LR1 compatibility. Remember, LR1 is a subset, proper subset of deterministic context-free grammar. So it is not that all deterministic context-free grammar has LR1. No. Then you might argue, what is the LL1? LL1 is top-down parsing, and you have to look at from the left side of it. You want to get to your S, that is the star symbol, from the terminals. But it is easily conceivable. And we know that if it is S grammar, that is very trivial, because S grammar, remember, all the rules starts with a new terminal, different terminal. There's another Greiberg number form. It can be done, but Greiberg number form doesn't say that every rule should start with a new terminal. No, Greiberg number form doesn't say that. But all this form we have already found, because we have already found that the Chomsky's normal form is the best. Why the Chomsky's normal form is the best? Because it's always the right side is a two variable. We also know the context sensitive grammar, there is another version of Chomsky's normal form. Okay, that is the right hand side can be a two variables, and left hand side also two variables. Left hand side two variables, not more than this. Right hand side two variables or one terminal, like an extension of Chomsky's normal form. Anyway, but they are in the context sensitive grammar, which is very interesting, like a to the power n, b to the power n, c to the power n grammar or WW grammar. We need certain kind of sentences parsing, then the NP complete problem. That is the reason NP completeness has come, NP completeness is a very tough problem, then you say why, so how it can be done. Yes, there are several tricks. Some tricks are there, approximation techniques there, randomization techniques there. Probably you are going through all these various tricks so that even the tough problem can be solved. Another example of NP complete problem is 3SAT. Another is a factorization problem. A big number is given, you have to solve it. We have started with the Michael Sifter's examples, like 13 into 7 is equal to 91, but whenever you are giving 91, it is very, very difficult to get it right now 13 to 7, but computer can do it in a microsecond. But if you give a big prime number, say 309 digit prime number, and you give it to computer, still computer cannot find it. So that is a not prime number. If you ever give a big number, it definitely looks like a prime, may not be prime. Then it has some, it is already, I have already shown in Michael Sifter's lectures, and you can find the Michael Sifter's book and lecture. Then 309 number of datas are there, 309 of the decimal there, and it is very difficult to find. So factoring problem is one of the NP complete problem. That is the two basic, 3SAT, factoring. Then I have told the click problem. Click problem is, if you are a Facebook friends and everybody is connected to each other, may not be, maybe in your class, but you want to call a Google Meet so that after the exam, so that everybody is connected to each other in a Facebook, then you can, it is sometimes difficult to get the maximum click. The maximum click, say if 100 nodes are there, to get the maximum click, it's a huge computer problem. It's a, maybe 10 computer years. So it is not so easy, but there are some techniques out there. Like I have told you the traveling salesman problem. Traveling salesman problem, a person starts from a particular city or town and cover all the city and town of the West Bengal, say for any marketing job, and again come back to Kolkata. No town should be visited twice, and they should traverse one and only one. And that is the Hamiltonian path. That is called Hamiltonian path or Hamiltonian circuit. And then we have to know whether Hamiltonian circuit is there or not. That is a decision problem. And if it is found, whether you have to find whether that particular path is there or not. But whenever you say we want to know the lowest Hamiltonian path, then it is not NP complete problem. It is a more harder. That is the NP hard problem. So there is subtle differences between NP complete and NP hard. NP complete means whenever you have give solution, it can be quickly find it out. And NP hard is, even if you are giving a solution, it is difficult to find it out, like exponential. There are other end of the problem is the highest end in the, that is the our Turing-Halting. And it has been proven that multi-tape Turing machine, all can be simulated by a single tape Turing machine.
Sir, can you then again the difference between recursively enumerable language and recursive language?
You follow the Michael Sifter's book. See, there in whenever the type 0 grammar comes, that when the type 0 grammar comes, there are many layers. The nearest layer to the type 0 grammar, it is a recursive language. What is a recursive language is, if you recursive language rules, if you complement those rules, those are also decidable. What I want to say that whenever you give a language, and the, what is the complement of the language? Complement of the language is the sigma star minus that, okay, L. So if you are given a language, it is a, say L, okay. And L is a set of the strings which is accepted by the production rules of the language. Then what is the complement of this language? It is a sigma star. Sigma star is, means it takes care of all the possible strings or sentences of this language. The sigma star minus L is the complement of the language. If you make a sentence from the sigma star minus L to a Turing machine, whether Turing machine halts or not, in the recursive language it will halt always. Even for the case of L it will halt, even in the sigma star minus L it is also halt. So it is halting in both the cases. That is the easiest, that is the recursive language. But what is recursively enumerable language is, whenever you are given a language from L, it will halt. But if you take any string sigma star minus L, you give it to that Turing machine, and it may or may not halt. That is a recursively enumerable language. What is recursive? Recursive language is, in Michael Sifter's book, it is called Turing decidable. that is easy to remember. Turing recursive language and Turing decidable are the same. And the next is recursively enumerable language. So you can say recursively enumerable language is its bigger name, and it is a Turing recognizable. Okay, what is the difference between decidable and recognizable? Decidable means understand the language and the complement of the language well, and the recognizable means we understand the language but complement. I am not sure whether Turing machine halt or not. It might say sometimes halt, but sometimes may not halt. Then there comes the Turing halting problem and other problems. PCB problem, I will give a note on PCB. Always it can say it cannot be halt. That is the toughest problem. That is no algorithm. But the beauty of this, if you kind of find an algorithm, that can be solved by a Turing machine. That's the beauty.